Good morning. Thank you for being here today at the final conference of ES Project. Some technical information. You can choose your language by pushing the button at the bottom. If you have any problem, you can write a message in chat to Judith. Okay, it's an honor for me to introduce this conference, this final conference. My name is Bianca Baron, Vice Director of CNC, the Joint National Committee of Building Workers Fund. National Committee of Building Workers Fund, the Italian Sectoral Fund for Construction Workers, known as Casse Edili. Before to start, I want to greet our partners and guests on behalf of our presidency, Cristina Ravitta and Carlo Tristini. And as a CNC, we are very proud of the result gained with the YES project. And for this reason, I'd like to thank all people who have contributed to the implementation thereof. Let me thank all partners for their strong effort in this project. The research centers, Fondazione Brodolini from Italy, Notus for Spain, the universities, Center of Social Studies for the University Institute of Lisbon from Portugal, the Policy University from Albania, the Trade Union Budulani from Poland, and the Paritarian Institution, Fondazione Laborano Fasturi Principate from Spain, Enzo Cabau from Germany, and the European Association of Paritarian Institution, IAP. And I hope to have forgotten anyone. As we know, after it started in 2020, the project research and the dissemination activities suffered for the pandemic, but this has meant great difficulties. But despite of this, we are here today, unfortunately not yet in presence, but nonetheless to report on the important results of the project. As you know, also YES project is the result of a path started a few years ago with the other European project in the field of posting workers, implemented with the financial contribution of the European Commission. I am referring to PostLab, to European PostLab, and to ISA project, the International Sharing Agreements project. As a final step, ISA contributed to the creation and to the promotion of information sharing agreements between public institutions and stakeholders to enforce legislation on costing. With the YES project, we went a step further by also focusing on training and its effect on costing. YES project, in fact, identified and addressed not only activity promoting transnational cooperation between stakeholders, but also increasing accessibility, transparency, and quality of information available to posted workers and to their employers, promoting an evidence based on the role of skill as a driver of posting, as well as on related barriers and opportunities. These are important and sensitive issues, especially in the context we live, and bear in mind that the relationship between training and posting is still an unexplored topic, even at the European level. The intention of the project, as you know, the intention of the project partners, as you know, was precisely to deepen to understanding of the role of training, skills, and qualification in the posting of workers, and how measures in this field can ensure greater protection to the workers involved in posting, and therefore represent an incentive to a free movement of services that guarantees both fair competition and decent worker conditions. The research and comparison activities took place throughout focus group, international seminars, interviews, literature analysis and data collection and processing. The results are already available on and freely available on the project website, www.mbsproject.net. Project reports addressed to the project issues from a national and comparative perspective. Today, our conference will focus on the most important findings on our final recommendations that we will find soon in the EOL toolkit published on our website in English, Italian, and in the other project languages. Now, I'd like to underline the importance of the last issues introduced by the Italian social partner in the construction sector in the last renewal of the collective agreement, regarding, in particular, sectoral training. Continuous vocational training of workers and of young people and its constant updating is at the heart of the contractual provision of this renewal. And the social identity card of the construction sector, inspired by some European models, have been introduced, including information on all attend training courses for each workers and will be realized by CNC. Workers who have a certain seniority in sector and who have attended vocational courses will be granted in the application of jobs profiles entailing either minimum wage rates. At the same time, CNC prosecutes a cooperation with the Italian Minister of Labor for sharing data on posting of workers. Now, before to let this interesting conference begin, I want to thank all the speakers present today for their valuable contribution. Thank all of you for your attention. Now, I leave the floor to Feliciano, whom I would particularly thank for his precious dedication, especially now that he is in our team. And it's all. Thank you, Feliciano. You have the floor.
Thank you very much, Bianca. I will share my screen to briefly introduce the main findings, recalling that there are the main research findings are really available in the EU background paper and in the EU handbook, available on the YES website. And then the recommendations that I will present are available in much more detailed way, will be available in much more detailed way in the website very soon by this week. I guess you can see my screen now. So first of all, just to show the composite partnership that contributed to this project from the covered countries, Italy, Albania, Germany, Poland, Portugal, Spain, and AIP from Belgium for the dissemination at EU level. The parties more specifically are the Policy University, the Sectoral Fund Sogabau, Fondazione Giacomo Brodolini, SRL as a Research Center from Italy, the Research Center Notos from Spain, the University of Lisbona from Portugal, the Trade Union Budovlani for Poland, the Vocational Training Center Fondazione Laborale della Costruzione of the Asturias Principate from Spain, and CNCA as project coordinator. Moving to the main results, which are already available in our online reports, we address as a first trend information gaps of posted workers, and our findings basically point to difficulty to access information due both to some reinforcing actually factors, language barriers, which includes the languages of the national website on posting, the poor availability in languages other than English and the national languages, whereas the enforcement directive would require them to be available, to consider at least the trends in posting when deciding on the languages that this website should be available, and the isolation of posted workers from host countries, colleagues and unions, possibly also because of their fragile situation. We shall not think that that posted workers are not applied the proper working condition, that the applicable terms of employment, just because of negligence by companies, but we have been reported also much difficulties by the companies themselves, especially small companies, to understand which are the applicable legislation, because they may seek for assistance, of consultants, which are actually specialized in the country, in the legislation of their country, and which may have not a specific knowledge on what's applicable in the field of social security coordination or on terms and conditions of employment applicable in what is, in the end, a foreign country. Which services we found to try to counteract these difficulties, this trend? We have some experiences developed mostly by unions like AFPWW or sectoral funds like Sogabau, which try to make information available in different languages. This is an obvious, actually, approach, and likely it has been implemented by private organizations. So they try, by which they try to reach out workers. How they try to reach out workers? There is, of course, a gap between the production of information and the delivery of information. So in some cases, we see also some attempts to reach out workers directly in construction sites or to make information available through easy-to-read guides. In Poland, we have other examples whereby they try also to overcome these language barriers by developing some vocational training courses in the languages of origin of migrant and posted workers. You see also in the report, sometimes we address them together because we consider that posting for some workers may be a stepping stone to then find another job in their country. And that also for some topics, if we think about occupational safety and health, the rules may be pretty similar, actually the same. We identified also some good practices by large companies which are preparing workers before posting, for instance, on the applicable income taxation rules, on everyday life in the host country, on the, what will be the travel and accommodation arrangement. And this is, those are also good practices that can help to posted workers to get acquainted with the place they will work in. We have also tried, as excellently pointed by Bianca, to address skills-related drivers of posting in these relationships. There are now some data being developed by also some sister projects funded under the Law Call for Proposal and also on the basis of national declaration, but it is still difficult to have quantitative information on these aspects. Our Canting Focus paper also develops on the on Italian administrative data or sectoral funds to provide some hints, but it was pretty difficult to generalize the findings for all the covered countries. Nevertheless, standing on this data and on the qualitative findings on interview to companies, social partners, but also other stakeholders like chambers of commerce, the following can be said. We see that there are some recurrent skill mismatches, labor shortages in most of the covered countries, and I'm talking specifically for Portugal, Italy, and Germany, but also in part for others, for some occupations, like for electricians, welders. In for Germany and Italy also, several stakeholders mentioned the need for tunnel boring operators. And in a way, posting can help to fill these mismatches. Even if there is also the counter-argument, no, that the risk can be actually that the use of posting may slow down the implementation of necessary training activities to have a workforce better prepared at home in these occupations. Another link that we found that it's not strictly linked with skill, but maybe approximable, is the presence of some trust networks, the role of trust. So we found that many multinational hotel and the retail chain tend to contract out their works, for instance, to Finnish or to realize their store or their hotel to some specific companies, regardless of the country where they operate, because probably they have, again, a link of trust with this company. So those are traveling around Europe or even abroad. Finally, in some cases, we have been reported by some large companies which, exactly because of the costs associated with posting, if you are respecting all the rules, also with travel, travel for accommodation and all the logistic organization, when awarded large works, prefer not to send their actual medium to low skilled workforce, but to send abroad their managers, their technicians, and then to hire in loco the mid to low skilled workforce, which paradoxically, in a way, not really, if you think actually about the reading of the directive, is cheaper if hired in loco and does not have obvious barriers like the language barriers that we mentioned above. Moving on to the recommendation, here also we have basically two strands. One strand focusing on the access to information and one more specifically on skills and qualification. For work consent, access to information, again, I said at the beginning, obviously, national website on posting cannot be available only in English. They should be available also in other languages. This is not a sufficient condition, of course, to reach out posted workers. We propose also, again, to develop short guides on the basis of some good practices, but also to narrow the gap, for instance, with the possibility to have live chats where companies or workers can ask information to national authorities if there are some doubts, or to work as a team with social partners, for instance, but also with other stakeholders. It could be the chambers of commerce, depending on the country context. Join forces to deliver reliable information, possibly also on the basis of joint protocols. Finally, another of our main proposal is to develop an onboarding process for posted workers. On the one side, this can be done by companies. As said before, no, there are really some good practices, but this is also targeted at public institutions. So if posted workers following the national declaration are assigned a contact person at local level, for instance, at public employment services, who is trained, of course, about these specific rules applicable in case of posting, they may have also a person to ask, they may be more reliable, and they may have to seek easily for information on which rules apply to them, rather than looking now for legal text, for instance, or for having to sort it out by themselves. Here are some examples. Many of the examples I mentioned today will be later explored during the debate. The website of Sogabau, available in 14 languages, with information, for instance, here in Italian about the benefits of the fund, but also with the possibility to call, to have a contact center, basically a call center in many, many languages, manifold languages, as you can see. A guide developed by the Polish Labor Inspectorate for Ukrainian workers, with easy figures also, and providing basic information on how to prevent accidents. Okay, here the Italian Observatory, which includes actually public research institutes, trade unions, employers organizations, and this fought specifically, no, to monitor data on posting and promote joint campaigns. I will move on to the other set of recommendations concerning posting, vocational training, and fair competition. First of all, here, also ahead of the difficulties, the labor shortages we have found, and the difficulties to recognize actually workers' qualifications across the countries, also beyond the topic of posting, we propose to support the development of the European qualification framework and develop better tools to understand and compare the available national qualifications framework. There are some examples in this respect. There are some practices like the database developed by SEDEFOP. There are also databases developed by European institutions only for regulated professions. We think that this can be that there can be more information available, for instance, on the procedure for recognized qualifications and on the contents of how to obtain a qualification, if a training course is necessary, or if also on the job training is required, and possibly to cooperate with social partners in order to provide at least some guidance on how this qualification can be reconciled with the job titles that in many countries, according to collective bargaining, define the wage level a worker is entitled to. Another ambition that we have, another proposal we make, is to set up a system to verify and acknowledge posted workers in general and posted workers' actual qualifications and experience, which is linked actually to the following recommendation: to make sure they have proper training in the field of occupational safety and health. And here we look specifically at the experiences of some social ID cards, like the one developed in Spain on a voluntary basis, which keep track on the information on the qualification, but also on the working experiences, on the attended courses of workers. And this way, if in line also with the proposal that was made recently by the European Parliament, jointly by the European social partners, produce some data, which if made interoperable, can help also to verify if the workers are applied, for instance, the correct wage level when they are sent abroad. Here a poster about the TPC, so the card I told about, but Marta Grafano will tell more about it later. And here I link with the recommendation concerning health and safety, so make sure workers have health and safety training. With the one I'm going to say, I make this link via the another practice, which is briefly mentioned in our toolkit, which is the Spanish Register of Accredited Companies. So construction companies, if they wish to be contracted out works in the construction sector, must meet specific quality requirements in regard to harsh management. So there is a database which is to be screened before to contract out works to these companies established at local level. And of course, then the difficulty is to enforce properly these rules, also because you need to have developing this, deploying it at national level needs also appropriate competencies, not only at the central level, but also among local administration and enforcement bodies. So starting from this experience, one of our proposals is to make the establishment of companies active in the construction sector conditional upon the possession of adequate competencies. If this is implemented at European level, we could have a new tool to fight letterbox companies, because so far it is possible in many countries to set up a company, even in the construction sector, overnight, and then possibly to use it to send workers around Europe. A complementary recommendation concerns the promotion of involvement of qualified workers and lifelong vocational training, for instance, by means of public procurement. If we think about the National Recovery and Resilience Plan, we have again a powerful tool. If the tenders associated with this plan rely on quality criteria, on social criteria, and again, adequately prepare also then the local public administration, possibly also establishing cooperation with inspectorates to make sure that the social criteria defined in the tender and then in the proposal are respected, we have again a tool to steer the market toward a competition based on quality. Finally, if across the former recommendation, we are looking especially at the threats that arise from mobility, this last recommendation looks at the opportunities, because we also went through many good practices. Many of them will be presented again in the following debate, whereby the companies exploited mobility, for instance, to have workers prepared to act in different contexts, to implement some peculiar restoration works, as we've seen with the Scuola Edile of the vocational training school of Arezzo, or to act in contexts where there is peculiar attention to health and safety at work, so or even simply to learn the basics of the language. So in a way, if adequately supported by vocational training schools, companies and public institutions, companies can use mobility also to train their workforce, especially the young one. A final transversal recommendation, which I did not include here, concerns the digitalization. Digitalization can be a transversal tool to implement most of these recommendations more effectively. We have explored, again, some examples in the projects, but on this point, I leave the floor to Professor Michele Faioli from Fondazione Bodolini, who has deeply explored the topic and that will today tell us some hints on how blockchain can be actually used to implement the functioning of the labor market in construction and beyond. Thank you very much for your attention, and Michele, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Feliciano. I'm very happy to be here to you all. I'm seeing actually many familiar faces and Feliciano, Giovanni, Carapella, Bianca and other friends that I met in several times also around these social matter. As Feliciano anticipated, I will focus on the connection between blockchain tech and labor market activation, focusing on a research project I'm carrying out with my research unit at Università Cattolica, also involving Fondazione Brodolini and other institutions, and I strongly hope to involve CNCE in this research project in the next future. Our time is limited. I will try to stay in more or less 10 minutes. I'm going just to start. Before starting, let me highlight a theoretical point I believe that is very important to understand what I'm going to explain to you all. My theoretical idea is based on this fundamental point. Labor market is not a radical market, or is not among the radical markets. When we say radical markets, we say a market where auction is the basing mechanism to create matchmaking. This means, in theoretical terms, that when you want to hire a worker, you are not buying a commodity. You are not buying just time. You are searching for a professionality, or whatever is a potential professionality. Now, this means that labor is not only not a commodity, but labor is more than a commodity. That means that you should find a way to make whatever we can call a tech mechanism, a platform, a blockchain tech, whatever you want to use, has a digital tool facilitating matchmaking within the labor market. You need that this technology should be transparent, able to certify the professional abilities, should be able to patrol the development of your competence, should be able to monitor the improvement of your competence, should be able to inform and to communicate what you are getting in your professional life, also by means of the upskilling, reskilling, whatever is training, professional training in your life. And on the other side, the employer should be able to monitor, to get in contact, to visit, to understand whatever is happening in your life as worker. So in order to create a efficient matchmaking by means of digital tool, we need a tool that is able to realize all these aims simultaneously. And in our research, university research, we got that blockchain could be a very efficient tool to realize all these aims in a simultaneous context. Let's see together some slide, and let's see together how and to what point we are in our research. I'm going to share my... Yeah, you are able to see my slide, I hope. So, you know, reworking, reskilling, activation, and social blockchain, a new frame for the Italian labor market. I carried out this research with some fellows, among those Alessandro Smilari. What I would like to stress by means of these slides is this point: how and to what extent we can improve the Italian labor system by implementing a social blockchain. This means that blockchain is not only analyzed under the tech viewpoint and is no longer connected to the financial market, fintech, but is completely devoted to what we call social matters. For this reason, I created this idea of social blockchain, that is a complementary concept between what we normally call and understand as blockchain and what we consider social issue. I will fastly analyze the activation policies reforms into Italian labor market, what is blockchain and smart contracts, and the preliminary uses of social blockchain within the Italian and European market. First point, when we see what is social labor market activation, at least for the Italians, experts and scholars means to see 6 points that are also on a timeline frame. We can start with the Pacchetto Treu of 1997, then finish to the Reform Orlando on 2022, related also to the Next Generation Italian Plan. In all these reforms, Treu, Biagi, Fornero, Jobs Act, Decreto Dignità, Reform Orlando, we can find at least 3 platforms that we consider something like, you know, essential element of our labor market activation policies. First, the linking between the active and the passive policies. When we say that, as of Pacchetto Treu, we tried to link by means of the conditionality legal mechanism the earning of a social security benefit concerning unemployment to the chance to be reactivated within the Italian labor market, European labor market. The principle of the legal technique that is used is called conditionality, in the sense that you are buttressed in your capacity to be reactivated in the labor market by means of training course or offers of labor new jobs, new places in the labor market. The second point is the reducing of a bureaucracy by means of technology. The third point is the increasing of the decentralization of decisions. That means that we have a pyramidal structure where on the top we have the regions that are in charge and strongly focused on the realization of the labor market activation policies. Well, the mix up of these 3 elements, more or less realized as of 1997, is the most critical point of the Italian labor market, the mix-up or the strange mix-up of these 3 elements. Why I'm saying that? Because unfortunately, we did not realize it or fully realize it, the conditionality technique. So, you have on the book, on the law, the conditionality principle well written, but as a matter of fact, it's very difficult to realize it when you are in front of an unemployed worker that is looking for be reactivated in the Italian labor market. Second, the reducing bureaucracy trends is still there. I mean, is still a name. And technology, unfortunately, is no linked to a national widespread structure, but given the decentralization tendency that we had as of 2001 in Italy, the decentralization created a sort of regional bureaucracy, and that the technology is linked not to the national level, but to the regional level. So we have several data sets, database, and so on, that are linked to the regions, and they are not interconnected with the national structure or with a potential national structure. All this mix up that creates this critical analysis of what we call labor market has required or is requiring a new frame. For this reason, we as university, as scholars, as experts, decided to move from what we can call a classical centralized data set that is interconnected to the local data set concerning the labor market activation, to what we can call social blockchain, because social blockchain is a leverage, is a technology that allows to maintain the data at local level, but at the same time, this data can be registered in what we call, or we can call, a national or supranational digital structure, that is the blockchain. Of course, we are talking about a private blockchain. There are some advantages of this tech, like trust, immutability, transparencies, and also the way to use smart contracts that are something in between tech and the legal tools that could be used in order to check the conditionality of the workers. What we had implemented as a research group, we are working on a social blockchain to create a digital wallet for workers. And this digital wallet for workers was introduced with the Jobs Act, but unfortunately never implemented. It is based in our research project on the idea that is a closed blockchain where you have some labor institutions joining such blockchain, like Minister of Labor, Social Security, training, vocational training authorities, and so on. The idea is to use blockchain in order to register all the vocational training session or whatever the worker can complete, can carry out, and have everything within the digital wallet, and such digital wallet based on the blockchain. And this could in some way be the base for the matchmaking, as I said before in my introduction. A second experimentation that we are carrying out is related to the social blockchain for the personalized service pact. That is a pact that is negotiated between the worker searching for a new job and the public authorities or the private operators of the labor market reactivation. So the unemployment can register in the blockchain, reporting the termination of the employment. Maybe this could be also automatized in some way. Blockchain notifies unemployment to job centers or private operators. Job centers and private operators propose the PSP suitable for the worker, and if the unemployed person accepts such PSP, the agreement is uploaded to the blockchain as a smart contract, and this in some way can create a virtuous circle of matchmaking between data, willingness, and so on. The benefits is the increasing of efficiency, suitability, security, no intermediation with the institution that could create bureaucracy, and this is also a way to save cost. Another experiment that we are carrying out and following is social blockchain for a decentralized employment system. Is a way to simplify recruitment and job seeking, clarify the, also the stages of the employment relationship. So we have a sort of platform that is based on blockchain where job offers and job application are published. And this create a matching or let's say easier matching between supply and demand. The blockchain checks that all job offers comply with the current legislation. And of course, with all the data that are related to the digital wallet of the person in search of a new job. This means that on the blockchain, you have the registration of the vocational training, of your professionality, of your history, and so on. And the blockchain could make easier the positive outcome of the selection process. Also, giving or managing some mandatory communications between institution, among institution, dealing with the labor market activation. The benefits are, of course, a faster recruitment process and also a real fighting against undeclared work because everything is transparent, everything is registered. And the last point, because the time is really limited and I'm going to close, we would like to apply our research in labor, legal, and tech, also to the recent NSBA for construction sector of the last week's negotiated and bargained at Italian level, where you can find a clause creating the so-called carta d'identità professionale edile. Such carta identità professionale edile, CIPE, could also be based on what we are calling social blockchain. Because if we correctly understood in the aims of the social partners bargaining such NSBA, the main idea is that all the training, skilling, upskilling, reskilling frames regarding that individual, that employer, should be mandatory, registered by means of the paritarian institution, Casse Edili, also for the purposes of safety at work. So the idea that we are building up and we are going to propose to CNCE is to create a sort of partnership with the university in order to understand if our social blockchain frame could be suitable for such project of the social partners concerning the construction sector in Italy. We believe that it could be done also because recently we had an experience for the mechanical sector where they created the Metaprento, that is a paritarian institution aimed at creating a digital wallet for the training frame concerning the employer, the employee, and the matchmaking with the employer needs, that is strongly based on social blockchain. So, this means that it's possible. This means that the pilot is already there. This means that social blockchain could be at Italian, and we also hope at European level, the best digital tool in order to foster this idea of making transparent and efficient the labor market activation of the workers. Thank you very much for your attention. And Feliciano, I will give back the floor, please.
Thank you very much, Michele, for the interesting presentation, very much in line also with the aims of the project and what with the discussion that we had with the partnership also in this and on previous projects, actually, on the possible manifold opportunities of digitalization. And I also wish that there will be opportunities to implement some of the provision entailed by law, some of the examples you suggest, and also to discuss the possibility to have a CIPES, so a professional social card, in the construction sector structured in a similar way. Now I'll leave the floor to Giovanni Carapella, director of CNCA, who have thanked for the strenuous efforts to coordinate the project over the last 2 years, despite the pandemic, and who will introduce the debate with all partners who join, of course, these efforts about the insight and proposal for posting and fair competition in the construction sector, as for the experience we had together in the project.
Allora, buongiorno a tutti. Parlerò in italiano. Riprendiamo in questo giro di tavolo con i partner tutti i temi che sono stati introdotti da Feliciano e dal professor Faioli, che saluto, in un giro di tavolo con i partner, perché questo è stato un progetto effettivamente europeo, in cui ci sono stati dei meeting internazionali, delle ricerche multilaterali e anche degli interessantissimi momenti di scambio e di confronto bilaterali tra paesi, che hanno prodotto degli approfondimenti validi un po' più in generale. Allora, comincerei da Joanna Marques dell'ISTEU, il Centro di Ricerca e Studi Sociologici dell'Università della Splendida Lisbona, che saluto, per riprendere il tema dell'accesso alle informazioni da parte dei lavoratori distaccati. Questo gap di informazioni, questo lavoratore straniero che si trova straniero in un paese di accoglienza, è uno dei grandi problemi. Le attività di ricerca sviluppate in Portogallo sulle difficoltà segnalate da aziende, da sindacati, da autorità pubbliche nell'affrontare il distacco da parte dei lavoratori, in particolare dei più giovani. Joanna, a te la parola, illustraci qualche riflessione che voi avete fatto e che può essere utile. Lo dico adesso per tutti i relatori, per dare un po' di snellezza al giro di tavolo, diamo un 5 minuti a testa per questo giro di orizzonte. A te, Joanna.
Thank you, Giovanni. Good morning, everyone. Yes, indeed, the Portuguese research has been identifying several difficulties in what concerns access to information in posting. But I would like to start by also highlighting that our team in Portugal that started researching posting in 2017 with you, we have seen important improvements and more awareness on this topic, which at the beginning was very unknown. So we have had the opportunity to involve the ACT, the Portuguese Labor Inspectorate, in some of these projects on posting. And we believe it has been very important and very fruitful, both from the perspective of the research to get more in-depth knowledge of this new field, and also from the perspective, the possibility of involving them in the discussion and in the implementation of the solutions to the different issues that we have identified. So I think it's important to start by acknowledging that. So nowadays, ICT has a whole range of information available for post workers in different languages, in their local offices, in their websites. They developed campaigns targeting posted workers and the companies that post. And they have new tools available to access information, that such as a new chat function in their website, an hotline for direct contact with workers and companies. So many improvements have been taking place. The main barriers that we still identify, according to the social partners that we have interviewed, is that though the information is and the tools are available, they do not reach posted workers. They are often not aware, and they still don't have access to this information. So they are, many of them are still not aware of on their labor rights in the host countries. And we believe there is still much room for improvement in the way the information and the tools are communicated and which channels we use so that we can actually reach those that most need this information, especially the less educated and who are more vulnerable. On the side of unions, by their very nature, they are more on the ground, so they tend to have a closer relationship with workers. And they told us, the unionists that we have interviewed told us that they, some workers contact their union before they go to a new undertaking to know where their, for instance, whether the labor contract is well done and if it complies with the, what the employer promises them orally. But in most cases, when workers reach the union, is when they are already in extreme situations of, so only after being exploited and without being paid for several months, that's when they try to reach these social partners that are on the ground. We should also mention that in recent years, we have an added challenge that is related to the issue of labor shortage in Portugal and in the construction sector, which also open spaces for new abusive practices and that are now also affecting workers from third sectors, non-EU member states, that are more prone to abusive practices. And that's why, from our perspective, it's very important to give visibility to this more opaque side of posting that is more difficult to capture and that is not present in official data, and also escape any existing mechanisms that we try to implement. So the research we have conducted so far, in our opinion, still lacks this more direct voice of the posted workers. This is would raise new challenges for the research, but it would be essential to capture all these more invisible issues that still are on the table. If I have time, I could also speak a little bit from the side of companies that we also had the opportunity to interview in this project. And they also reported several difficulties related to complying all the requirements and the complying, especially to the difficulty to accompany the evolving legislation in the different countries where they post. They claim that the administrative burden is still very heavy and could be simplified. They also claim that national and international authorities take too long to respond when they make information requests. And as Feliciano has mentioned, to overcome this difficulty, they hire local consultancy companies, so to be sure that they comply with legal requirements. But this also represents an additional cost that not all companies are able to pay for it. So especially when for the small countries, the small companies, this raises another set of questions. We could also mention that to address all a set of barriers that have been identified, we have an interesting case study of a big business, large business group in Portugal that has developed a certified training center as part of its activities, providing hundreds of different courses that are targeted to all workers and also posted workers. And this and all courses try to address issues of behavioral skills that have been identified as particularly important for posted workers. Sometimes if it's more focused on posting, they may include issues related to local culture and these kinds of questions that we have also identified as an important barrier for the integration that often does not occur. And they have also implemented an interesting onboarding process for both for new workers and for every time a new posting takes place. So when workers are posted to a different country, they implement a set of strategies to facilitate integration in the new teams and in this new contents. And this is particularly a recommendation that we believe that could be implemented more broadly, and we could try to go deeper in this issue. The issue of language, this training courses also provides on-demand language courses, but we know that to also to mitigate this language barrier in posting, and it's also an important side of this approach. So very briefly, I think I've gone out of time. I think this would be my first answer to the contribution to this debate, and feel free to continue.
Grazie, Ioanna. Restiamo sul tema passando a Lisa Dornberger in rappresentanza di Socabau, che è uno storico partner per la nostra Commissione Nazionale delle Casse Edili Italiane, e avendo noi accordi bilaterali Italia-Germania da più di 10 anni e una solida collaborazione. Ioanna ci ha detto appunto che una di queste barriere è le informazioni che poi non arrivano ai lavoratori, soprattutto a quelli culturalmente più deboli e quindi più indifesi. Restiamo sul tema. In Germania voi avete sviluppato, Lisa, delle esperienze per raggiungere, oserei dire agganciare, i lavoratori distaccati e più in generale per superare le barriere linguistiche con i nuovi arrivati e con tutti i lavoratori in mobilità. Ce ne puoi parlare?
Ja, gerne. Vielen Dank. Ich werde meinen Beitrag auf Deutsch machen, um den Luxus zu nutzen, dass es Simultanübersetzung in 7 Sprachen gibt. Das gibt es ja wirklich selten. Also schon mal großes Lob an die Organisatoren. Und ich will auch noch einen Teil meiner Zeit kurz nutzen, um auch nochmal Danke zu sagen.
Exactamente, Lisa.
Nämlich, Bianca hat das am Anfang ja schon gut gesagt, ich glaube, die Zusammenarbeit war sehr schön. Und ich glaube, gerade bei einer letzten Konferenz darf man sich die Zeit kurz gönnen, vor allen Dingen auch denjenigen zu danken, die sich beteiligt haben. Ich sehe einige in den Zuschauerreihen, die auch immer wieder Input gegeben haben oder sich als Speaker bereit erklärt haben, an den Webinaren teilzunehmen. Aber vor allen Dingen, und das soll nicht zu kurz kommen, möchte ich gerne Feliciano danken, der uns allen wahrscheinlich immer die Deadlines gesagt hat und der dafür gesorgt hat, dass das Projekt immer vorwärts geht. Das nur kurz vorangestellt. Ich weiß, nach hinten raus wird die Zeit meist knapp. Und damit man trotzdem zu dem Dank kommt, habe ich den Inhalt jetzt mal ein bisschen nachrangig behandelt. Aber jetzt zur Frage. Danke für die Frage. Ich glaube, ich kann mich sehr gut anschließen an das, was Joanna gerade gesagt hat. Wir haben auch während des Projekts festgestellt, dass es sowieso recht natürlich sehr unterschiedlich die Systeme aufgebaut sind und es sehr unterschiedlich ist, aber wir auch viele Parallelen erkennen konnten. Und wenn man sich gerade den Informationsfluss ansieht, da ist es sehr ähnlich. Und ich glaube, aus deutscher Sicht betrachtet, ist Portugal dann auch noch mal einen Schritt weiter, wenn man sieht, dass zum Beispiel diese Chat-Funktion eingebaut wurde und dass man da versucht, auch Kurse anzubieten, um die Integration voranzutreiben. Soweit sind wir noch nicht. Ich kann definitiv aus Soka-Bau-Erfahrung sprechen und sagen, dass wir uns früh überlegt haben, wie wird man einem Entsendeverfahren gerecht. Und ich denke, wir kennen alle die Bedeutung von Informationen. Es braucht Informationen für die Arbeitnehmer natürlich, damit diese ihre Rechte geltend machen können. Aber es braucht die Informationen auch für die Arbeitgeber, wie Joanna das gesagt hat. Letztendlich ist das Durchdringen der komplexen, unterschiedlichen Systeme in den Ländern auch für die Arbeitgeber, je nach Größe des Unternehmens natürlich, auch besonders schwer. Deswegen braucht es gut verständliche Informationen. Wir haben das bei Soka-Bau damit gelöst. Das hat Feliciano ja auch schon eingangs gezeigt. Wir haben eine Website mit 14 Sprachen. Das heißt, alle Informationen werden wirklich in diesen Sprachen dargestellt. Teilweise haben wir auch auf den unterschiedlichen Sprachen Erklärvideos, die gut bebildert sind, die das vielleicht auch ein bisschen einfacher machen. Ich möchte uns aber auch jetzt nicht über den Klee loben, weil wir auch immer wieder gesagt bekommen, dass es trotzdem zu kompliziert ist. Es ist eine Herausforderung, juristische Sprache einfach zu gestalten, verständlich zu gestalten und trotzdem keine falschen Informationen zu liefern. Das ist auf jeden Fall eine Herausforderung, der wir uns auch immer wieder stellen. Und gesehen auf die nationale Website, die ja europarechtlich auch gefordert wird, spätestens seit der Durchsetzungsrichtlinie 2014, wo gesagt wird, man braucht Zugang zu oder einen leichten Zugang zu Informationen und man braucht diese nationale Website. Die haben wir in Deutschland, die ist bei uns angesiedelt beim Zoll. Das ist, finde ich, auch sehr sinnvoll. Und sie ist dargestellt oder stellt die wichtigsten Informationen zur Entsendung auch dar, auf Deutsch und Englisch. Aber, und das wurde jetzt ja schon vielseits angesprochen, diese zwei Sprachen reichen nicht aus. Es braucht zumindest, wenn nicht, natürlich wäre ein Wunschdenken, das in allen Sprachen zu haben. Aber wenn man es nicht schafft, es in allen Sprachen zur Verfügung zu stellen, dann sollte man sich zumindest daran orientieren, welche Länder am stärksten nach Deutschland in unserem Fall oder in die jeweiligen Länder entsenden. Das wäre, gut, die Österreicher haben kein Problem, aber das wäre Polen, das wäre Rumänien, das wäre Slowenien. Wenigstens in diesen Sprachen müsste es eine Darstellung geben. Dann wurde auch angesprochen, die reine Website reicht auch nicht aus. Wir merken, wie ganz natürlicherweise ist der Umgang mit Internet recht unterschiedlich unter Bauarbeitern oder auch den Arbeitgebern. Wir merken das in unserer täglichen Praxis immer wieder, dass zum Telefonhörer sehr gerne gegriffen wird. Das heißt auch, so wie es Joanna zum Beispiel auch gesagt hat, dass es so eine Kommunikationsmöglichkeit gibt, würden wir uns auch für Deutschland wünschen, dass es eine Art Hotline gibt für alle Mindestarbeitsbedingungen oder für alles, was mit dem Entsendeverfahren zu tun hat. Bisher bietet das Bundesministerium für Arbeit und Soziales eine Hotline an, aber nur zum gesetzlichen Mindestlohn und auch nur auf Deutsch. Da gäbe es natürlich noch Ausbaubedarf. Es wäre besser, wenn das noch ausgeweitet würde. Aber der Ansatz ist natürlich gut, auch dieses Telefonische nicht zu vernachlässigen. Der Schritt in die Zukunft ist sicherlich, alles im Internet parat zu haben und bereitzustellen. Aber gerade für die komplexen juristischen Probleme braucht es auch den Austausch. Es braucht die Möglichkeit, Rückfragen stellen zu können oder sich das einfach mal erklären zu lassen. Und deswegen wäre unser Anliegen auch definitiv eine telefonische Möglichkeit. Dann finden wir auch sinnvoll diese Chat-Funktion, weil es dann wenigstens eine Möglichkeit gäbe, Rückfragen zu stellen. Uns wurde auch zugetragen, dass die Internetnutzung häufig darauf beruht, nicht E-Mails zu benutzen zum Beispiel, sondern eher auf Facebook und WhatsApp zurückzugreifen. Das ist jetzt nicht so überraschend vielleicht, aber ich finde trotzdem, man sollte bei der Findung von Lösungen auch beachten, wie unterschiedlich das ist. Heißt jetzt nicht, dass wir alle Facebook und WhatsApp benutzen sollten. Datenschutzrechtlich wahrscheinlich so sehr schwierig. Aber trotzdem sollte man sich darauf einstellen, dass gewisse Kanäle vielleicht besser bespielt werden oder da mehr Informationen aufploppen, die auch interessant sein könnten. Und das Wichtigste finde ich in diesem ganzen Zusammenhang, natürlich Website ist wichtig, eine Hotline ist wichtig, Chat ist wichtig, aber ich glaube, nichts ersetzt wirklich die persönliche Beratung. Wir haben da in Deutschland glücklicherweise ein ganz gutes, finde ich jedenfalls, gutes Netzwerk, Beratungsnetzwerk mit Faire Mobilität allen voran. Faire Mobilität war ursprünglich ein Projekt des Deutschen Gewerkschaftsbundes und durch die revidierte Entsenderichtlinie und deren Umsetzung im Jahr 2020 dann in Deutschland wurde dieses Projekt zu einer Institution. Sie wurde gestärkt, finanziell, personell, und das ist besonders wichtig. Es ist wichtig, dass gerade so Beratungsnetzwerke nicht darauf angewiesen sind, zu schauen, wie lange sie eigentlich sich finanziell halten können, sondern wirklich frei agieren können, auch viel gute Möglichkeiten haben, die Beratung anzubieten, auch wirklich auf die Baustellen zu gehen. Ich glaube, dieser persönliche Kontakt wird niemals ersetzt werden durch andere Kanäle und sollte auch weiterhin ausgebaut werden, auch wenn das jetzt schon ein guter Schritt war. Es gibt noch andere Beratungsnetzwerke, zum Beispiel das PECO-Institut, der Europäische Wander-Arbeitnehmerverein, auch Arbeit und Leben, beziehungsweise Beratungsnetzwerk Gute Arbeit. Das sind alles Netzwerke, die auch einen wichtigen Beitrag leisten, um Arbeitnehmer vor allen Dingen zu beraten über ihre Rechte, aber die auch Unterstützung brauchen dabei, finanzieller Art, personeller Art. Und also das möchte ich als wichtigen Faktor herauskehren, dass man die nicht vergisst, die wichtige Arbeit nicht vergisst. Und letztendlich ist es für uns alle, je mehr Informationen an die Arbeitnehmer gelangen, desto weniger Probleme wird es geben. Wie Joanna schon sagt, meistens ergeben sich Beratungssituationen erst, wenn das Kind in den Brunnen gefallen ist, also erst, wenn es wirklich problematisch geworden ist oder wenn Arbeitsverhältnisse auch schon beendet worden sind. Präventives Handeln könnte solche Situationen definitiv vermeiden. Das würde uns als Sokabau auf jeden Fall auch entlasten, weil selbst wenn wir eigentlich nur eine Beratung zum Urlaubsverfahren anbieten, kommen bei uns auch etliche weitere Anrufe an über Steuerrecht, Sozialversicherungsrecht. Also es besteht Notwendigkeit für mehr Aufklärung im Entsendeverfahren. Das war aus deutscher Sicht erstmal, und ich glaube, wir sind eh schon in der Zeit gut vorangeschritten. Deswegen gebe ich gerne wieder zurück zu Giovanni.
Grazie, Elisa. E facciamo un salto un po' più su in Polonia, da Jakub Kuss, che rappresenta Budowlani, il sindacato dei lavoratori delle costruzioni del legno della Polonia. Buongiorno. Jakub, caro Jakub, innanzitutto noi è più di un mese che vediamo tutti i giorni le immagini del confine tra Ucraina e Polonia, le immagini di quello che sta succedendo, e anche oltre il richiamo ovviamente inevitabile al rifiuto della guerra e alla pace che pervade ciascuno di noi, Noi vorremmo chiederti delle conseguenze che ha sulla popolazione ucraina e sulla presenza degli ucraini che tu ci avevi segnalato in qualche meeting fa, molto forte nel settore delle costruzioni in Polonia. Come settore di polacco, come pensate che questo importante fenomeno di entrata e di uscita dalla Polonia possa influenzare il settore? Cosa pensate di fare?
Thank you, Giovanni, for this question, but the answer is a bit risky on this stage. Będę mówił po polsku, prosiłbym o przełączenie. Przede wszystkim chciałem bardzo serdecznie podziękować i Tobie, Giovanni, i Feliciano za doskonałe prowadzenie tego projektu i wszystkim partnerom za współpracę, również naszym krajowym partnerom, którzy dzisiaj biorą udział w tym seminarium, reprezentantom Zakładu Ubezpieczeń Społecznych, Państwowej Inspekcji Pracy, związkowcom i reprezentantom instytucji badawczych. Musimy zdawać sobie sprawę z faktu, że atak Rosji na Ukrainę, niezależnie od tego, że trwa w tej chwili wojna i nie wiemy, jak ostatecznie wpłynie to na, zarówno na ukraiński rynek pracy, jak i na europejski rynek pracy w budownictwie, będzie miało to ogromny wpływ na obydwa te rynki, czyli rynki krajów Unii Europejskiej i sam rynek ukraiński, także w zakresie delegowania pracowników. Wczoraj rozmawialiśmy także o tym z naszymi ukraińskimi partnerami budownictwa. We wschodniej Ukrainie ogromną większość firm budowlanych i innych też obecnie nie funkcjonuje. Większość pracowników nie otrzymało wynagrodzeń, bo firmy przestały istnieć lub właściciele wyjechali. Za granicę w tej chwili z Ukrainy wyjechało blisko 4 miliony obywateli, a wewnętrzni uchodźcy, szczególnie z terenów Ukrainy Wschodniej i południowej, to około 6,5 miliona osób. To są już bieżące dane Organizacji Narodów Zjednoczonych. W Polsce, która obecnie gości ogromną większość uchodźców, ale ci uchodźcy są również u was w Niemczech, we Włoszech, coraz większa ilość również. Dziś przede wszystkim są to kobiety, dzieci i nastolatkowie. Obywatele Ukrainy w Polsce otrzymują obecnie dostęp do polskiego systemu zabezpieczenia społecznego, ale również do systemu edukacji. W tym otrzymują również możliwość podejmowania pracy, tak jak polscy obywatele, i korzystania ze wszystkich publicznych usług medycznych. Także mają możliwość zakładania własnych firm. Otrzymują polski numer identyfikacyjny, czyli z legalnego punktu widzenia, najprawdopodobniej się nie mylę, będą traktowani tak jak polscy obywatele i wyjaśnienia wymaga również to, czy będą traktowani również tak samo w procesie delegowania. Obywatele ukraińscy są to, tak jak mówiłem, głównie w tej chwili kobiety, dzieci, nastolatkowie, otrzymali dostęp do polskich szkół. Już w tej chwili kilkadziesiąt tysięcy, ponad 100 tysięcy już chyba w tej chwili jest zarejestrowanych w polskich szkołach, w tym w szkołach branżowych, czyli w szkołach budowlanych. To również wpłynie na kwestię rozpoznawania kwalifikacji tych pracowników. Nie mówimy w tej chwili już o procesie tylko delegowania, chociaż ten proces delegowania też będzie miał tutaj spore znaczenie, i uznawania tych kwalifikacji. Na Ukrainę wróciło po wybuchu wojny około 400 tysięcy osób do dzisiaj, głównie mężczyzn. Mężczyźni w wieku 18-60 lat wyjeżdżają na Ukrainę głównie do służby wojskowej i w obronie terytorialnej. Szacujemy, że z Polski w tej chwili, z polskiego budownictwa, polskich firm budowlanych wyjechało co najmniej 40 tysięcy pracowników budownictwa. Wracając na Ukrainę, biorąc pod uwagę skalę zniszczeń, dezorganizację ukraińskiego sektora budowlanego, należy w przyszłości spodziewać się dużego przepływu pracowników budowlanych do krajów Unii Europejskiej. Czy to jako uchodźców, czy to jako migrantów. Trafią na rynki Unii Europejskiej także poprzez proces delegowania. Głównie podejrzewamy, że dużą aktywność będą tutaj przejawiały agencje pracy i na to chciałem położyć szczególny nacisk. Oczywiście przewidujemy, że w Ukrainie po zakończeniu wojny rozpocznie się wielka działalność inwestycyjna, odbudowa kraju. Ale to zależy od dostępności środków finansowych, również zewnętrznych środków finansowych. Ludzie muszą mieć z czego żyć, więc będą skłonni podejmować pracę tam, gdzie będzie źródło dochodu, w tym za granicą, także z wykorzystywaniem delegowania. I znowu podkreślam, przewidujemy tutaj dużą aktywność agencji pracy. Czy wpłynie to na proces delegowania w Polsce? Tak, w tej chwili w polskim budownictwie brakuje bardzo dużej ilości pracowników, niezależnie od problemu z dostępnością materiałów budowlanych, przede wszystkim stali i wzrostem ich cen, ale te zjawiska znacie również z własnych rynków budowlanych. W Polsce jest to szczególnie dotkliwe w tej chwili. Polskie firmy są zainteresowane, będą zainteresowane powrotem i większą ilością pracowników z Ukrainy. Jednocześnie większość krajów Unii Europejskiej uruchamia już w tej chwili krajowe plany odbudowy i uruchamia Renovation Wave chociażby. Polska jeszcze nie. Może to oznaczać, że przy zastoju na polskim rynku inwestycji, a to jest możliwe, duża liczba firm i pracowników będzie zainteresowana delegowaniem i pracą na innych rynkach Unii Europejskiej, także ze względu na znacznie wyższe wynagrodzenia, więc może czekać nas duża fala delegowania pracowników z obywatelstwem ukraińskim, ale również duża fala migracji w ramach też delegowania pracowników polskich w poszukiwaniu lepiej płatnej pracy, znacznie wyższa niż dotychczas. Oznacza to, że można się spodziewać w kolejnych latach zarówno wzrostu obecności pracowników ukraińskich na europejskim rynku budowlanym, w tym na podstawie delegowania, jak i wzrostu liczby delegowanych polskich pracowników w budownictwie. Jednocześnie spodziewamy się napływu ukraińskich pracowników do polskiego budownictwa i także w zakresie delegowania. Organizatorem, tak jak mówiłem, będą najprawdopodobniej przede wszystkim agencje pracy. To i sama masowa skala zjawiska rodzi obawy dotyczące ochrony praw pracowniczych i wzrostu liczby nadużyć w procesie delegowania, ale dotyczy też bezpośrednio tematu naszego projektu, mianowicie kwestii kompetencji, potrzeb kompetencyjnych, kształcenia, szkolenia pracowników i reorganizacji całego systemu. O ile w niektórych krajach, co dzisiaj zostało już powiedziane, Unii Europejskiej, te procedury istnieją, one będą musiały być nastawione na przyjęcie być może znacznie większej liczby zainteresowanych. O tyle w Polsce ciągle jesteśmy w procesie ich tworzenia. Ten problem dotyczący skutków, przewidywanych skutków wojny na Ukrainie, agresji Rosji na Ukrainę i na przepływy migracyjne, uchodźcy, ale migracyjne, uchodźcy też gdzieś muszą pracować, jest między innymi przedmiotem dodatkowego raportu Związku Zawodowego Budowlani w ramach projektu JES, będzie opublikowany w ramach rezultatów projektu. Tam Państwo znajdą więcej danych. Natomiast jeśli chodzi o sam proces kształcenia, szkolenia pracowników migracyjnych, w tym pracowników delegowanych, chociaż jest to niewielka część tego obszaru, Polska jest stosunkowo niewielkim krajem przyjmującym pracowników, ale za to wielkim krajem delegującym pracowników budownictwa, to tak jak mówiłem, będzie wymagało to zmian systemowych. Już w tej chwili ukraińscy uczniowie są obecni w Polsce i są podejmowane pewne działania mające na celu raz poszerzenie zakresu informacji, tutaj ukłony należą się Polskiej Państwowej Inspekcji Pracy za taką dość szybką reakcję, będą wymagały działań dotyczących kontroli warunków pracy, bo ten rynek może nie tyle się zorganizuje, ale będzie znacznie trudniejszy dla działań Inspekcji Pracy. Będzie wymagało również aktywności instytucji kształcenia i szkolenia pozaformalnego i samych pracodawców, na co zwracali uwagę już wcześniej, przed wojną na Ukrainie, w naszych case studies. Także problem jest otwarty i odpowiedź na to pytanie, które zadałeś, również jest otwarta, ponieważ skończył mi się czas, a mógłbym jeszcze bardzo długo na ten temat mówić, to na tym zakończę, takim dużym znakiem zapytania. Dziękuję bardzo.
Grazie Jacob, ovviamente noi siamo tutti molto interessati a questo report che voi farete come Budovlani sugli effetti di questa ondata migratoria improvvisa che avremmo tutti voluto che non ci fosse sul mercato del lavoro polacco e quindi sul settore delle costruzioni. Auspichiamo tutti che si arrivi presto al cessate il fuoco e alla pace come condizione per restituire agli ucraini la possibilità di vivere il proprio paese. Torniamo ad argomenti più frivoli, quale quello della formazione, del mutuo riconoscimento delle qualifiche. Chiamo in causa Gasbendi Lanai, Gas per gli amici. Gas è un architetto che coordina la formazione e la sicurezza nella scuola edile di Bologna, IPLE, ed è stato, come esperto della CNCE, anche un nostro referente di progetto. Chiedo a Gas, noi abbiamo spesso affrontato il tema di meccanismi efficaci di riconoscimento mutuo delle qualifiche e della formazione svolta in un paese anche a livello internazionale. Tu sei stato, Gas, partecipe di vari progetti europei. Se puoi, sempre nel limite dei 5 minuti, darci qualche valutazione, qualche esperienza in materia di corsi obbligatori di formazione per la sicurezza e salute nei cantieri e sul tema del riconoscimento reciproco.
Buongiorno a tutti. Faccio così, noto alcuni punti prima di fare un excursus brevissimo dell'esperienza di uno dei progetti europei che riguarda la formazione sulla sicurezza. E un punto importante, secondo me, che è venuto fuori anche durante tutti i nostri lavori, insomma, svolti in questo progetto, è stato quello della discrepanza che tutti notiamo, purtroppo, a livello europeo, questo, quindi tutti i paesi, tra quello che è il livello contrattuale dei lavoratori edili, quindi il livello formale, diciamo, e quindi il riconoscimento nel momento e nei documenti dell'assunzione, e dall'altra parte però anche un livello di qualifiche riconosciute che non sempre coincidono e non sempre sono in qualche modo diventano utilizzabili a livello di contratti di lavoro. E un terzo livello ancora, che è quello delle competenze reali. Quindi abbiamo uno scollamento tra 3 livelli differenti: uno che è quello contrattuale, il secondo è quello di qualifiche riconosciute ma non considerate all'interno dei contratti di lavoro, e un terzo livello che è quello della competenza reale, effettiva, delle persone. Dico questo perché l'altro punto che vorrei così segnalare è il fatto che le professioni edili, purtroppo a livello europeo, non hanno un riconoscimento immediato per quanto riguarda proprio lo scambio, quindi lo spostamento dei lavoratori da un paese all'altro, non dà necessariamente e non rende automatico, appunto, il riconoscimento delle qualifiche professionali che a noi interessano. Quindi nel nostro contesto parliamo quindi dei muratori, dei piastrellisti, dei cartongessisti, dei decoratori e così via. Questo passaggio non è purtroppo automatico, e questo è dovuto spesso appunto anche a quei punti, a quelle discrepanze che accennavo prima. E segnalo a proposito di questo, in Italia nell'ultimo mese c'è stato un passo importante fatto nel contratto nazionale degli edili, che in uno delle parti prevede espressamente che qualora un lavoratore edile faccia dei corsi di formazione, non quelli obbligatori sulla sicurezza, ma di formazione appunto professionale, venga riconosciuto a livello successivo anche a livello contrattuale questo sforzo appunto e questo avanzamento da un punto di vista delle competenze. E quindi è qualcosa, appunto, è una novità importante per l'Italia intanto. Tornando però al confronto tra i vari sistemi, appunto, come dicevo prima, non c'è un riconoscimento reciproco e immediato delle qualifiche da un paese all'altro. E purtroppo questo non c'è ancora. Se ne parla, ma non si arriva mai. Per quel che riguarda il nostro settore, questo scambio, questo riconoscimento è possibile dal livello dei tecnici in su. Quindi è possibile riconoscere i titoli per un architetto, per un progettista, un ingegnere, un tecnico qualificato in edilizia, ma non per tutte le professioni, quindi tutte le parti che più ci interessano, appunto, che riguardano maggiormente poi anche gli operai in distacco. E a proposito di questo, appunto, Noi abbiamo invece, con uno dei progetti europei nel quale io ho collaborato e che ho seguito, appunto, cercato di fare questo ragionamento e di immaginare un riconoscimento reciproco, trasversale, delle qualifiche, ma anche delle certificazioni sulla sicurezza in vari paesi europei. Condivido soltanto per un minuto lo schermo, abbiamo fatto un esercizio di stile e abbiamo fatto una formazione sulla sicurezza in tre paesi diversi. Quelli che vedete sono i numeri, appunto, delle persone che sono state, come dire, sottoposte a questo sistema e a questo modello formativo sulla sicurezza obbligatoria, quindi lavoratori edili. Parliamo della formazione obbligatoria. Ecco, fondamentalmente, insomma, abbiamo dovuto affrontare delle problematiche, perché chiaramente quando si tratta di formazione obbligatoria sulla sicurezza c'è in tutti i paesi, e l'essenza di quello che voglio dirvi, per non farla lunga e rimanere nei miei 5 minuti, è che nonostante ci siano delle differenze dal punto di vista della forma e anche nella modalità con la quale vengono erogati, riconosciuti questi corsi, noi abbiamo potuto dimostrare, appunto, che più o meno con le stesse ore e andando a confrontare anche effettivamente i programmi di formazione che vengono fatti nei vari paesi, siamo riusciti a farne uno che li include tutti, e quindi le persone che sono state formate hanno avuto anche un riconoscimento formale. Quindi questo corso che noi abbiamo organizzato nei vari paesi partner era contemporaneamente riconosciuto come certificazione della formazione obbligatoria per la sicurezza. E quindi questo ci ha fatto capire, appunto, che nonostante, appunto, le differenze formali, nella sostanza la formazione viene fatta bene, ma purtroppo, ed è appunto la cosa che con la quale concludo, sarebbe possibile ipotizzare facilmente un sistema di certificazione anche qui, ripeto, l'esempio è sulla sicurezza, ma potrei dirlo con quasi certezza che questo varrebbe anche per la formazione professionale e per le qualifiche professionali nei vari paesi europei. I contenuti e la realtà è più avanti di noi, è più avanti della forma. Quindi, nella sostanza, le persone sanno e sanno fare più o meno le stesse cose, ma la forma non permette di riconoscere facilmente e immediatamente, appunto, questo livello, appunto, di competenze.
Grazie Gas. Rimaniamo nel campo della formazione della sicurezza e salute sui cantieri, e chiamo in causa la Fondazione Laborale della Costruzione del Principato di Asturia, l'amica Marta Eviafano. La Fondazione Laboral è un partner storico del nostro sistema bilaterale italiano, organismo membro della rete europea Reform. Io a Marta chiederei di illustrarci nei soliti 5 minuti e accennarci a 2 esempi che già ha citato Feliciano nella sua presentazione. Il sistema di certificazione VCA, non so come lo chiamate in inglese, e la targhetta professionale della costruzione spagnola, a cui sicuramente farà riferimento e si ispirerà anche quella carta d'identità professionale edile CIPE appena introdotta dalle parti sociali italiane del settore delle costruzioni nella contrattazione di settore.
Grazie Giovanni. Bueno, como solo me das 5 minutos, voy a, y aprovechando que tenemos estas buenas colaboradoras en la interpretación, voy a hablar en español. Voy a empezar introduciendo efectivamente la TPC. La TPC es la tarjeta de la construcción que tenemos en España. Ya está vigente desde hace 10 años. Esta iniciativa surge a raíz de la ley de subcontratación en 2006, ya hace 15 años, en la que se insta a establecer por convenio colectivo un sistema de acreditación de la formación profesional en materia de prevención de riesgos laborales. Esta formación de prevención de riesgos laborales sí que va a ser obligatoria para todos los trabajadores que realicen sus servicios en el sector de la construcción. De hecho, en el convenio colectivo actual ya se describe cuáles son estos programas formativos y estos contenidos específicos que se deben impartir. Y se han de impartir en 33 ocupaciones, se identifican 33 ocupaciones relacionadas con el sector. Todas estas, estos currículos formativos se desarrollan, la base es, digamos, todos los requisitos mínimos que hay en materia de seguridad establecidos por ley, por la ley española, que no deja de ser una transposición exacta de lo que es la Directiva Europea 92/57. Es decir, que toda nuestra formación en materia preventiva se ha diseñado sobre una base de estándares comunes europeos. La formación mínima que damos nosotros es de 20 horas. Esta formación está dividida en dos partes, en una parte común de 14, que es común a las 33 ocupaciones, y luego hay 6 específicas para cada una de las especialidades. ¿Por qué? Pues porque cada especialidad tiene sus propios riesgos y, consecuentemente, sus medidas preventivas adecuadas a esos riesgos. Con lo cual, un trabajador con hacer un curso de 20 horas en cualquiera de estas ocupaciones ya es suficiente para no tener que volver a hacer otro de 20, sino que haría ya luego especialidades de 6, 6, 6, según la polivalencia que tenga en la obra y que requiera, ¿no?, para su actividad. Todas estas competencias están validadas por una institución única y se registran en esta tarjeta profesional, que es también única y para todo el territorio español. Hoy en día, el formato que tiene es una tarjeta física como una tarjeta de crédito, como las que vimos anteriormente también en el proyecto de STEAM que diseñaba Gasmem. Las pide la Fundación Laboral de la Construcción a nivel nacional, y que es, digamos, el organismo paritario del sector de la construcción, y además es quien coordina la base de datos nacional. Esta tarjeta no solo nos evidencia cuáles son las competencias en materia de seguridad de los trabajadores, sino también que recoge otro tipo de cualificaciones, su categoría profesional, experiencia que tenga en el sector e incluso también todos los exámenes médicos que se hagan por vigilancia de la salud. La formación es obligatoria, pero la tarjeta no. Sin embargo, la mayoría de las empresas de la construcción se la exigen a los trabajadores, se la piden, porque para ellos es mucho más fácil certificar de esa manera que cumplen, sus trabajadores cumplen con la normativa en materia de seguridad y también con la ley de subcontratación. Para los trabajadores también es muy importante, porque digamos que al estar toda su información centralizada en una base de datos, si algún día pierden algún documento o tienen que hacer algún duplicado o quieren actualizar algo, pues es mucho más sencillo para ellos el tenerlo ahí centralizado, y es un beneficio para todos. Los datos, el trabajador los consigue con su usuario y contraseña en una página web nacional común que tenemos todos, que es trabajoenconstrucción.com. Y bueno, esta es nuestra experiencia en España. ¿Cómo podemos sacar partido? Bueno, lo hemos estado viendo con todas las exposiciones que habéis ido comentando. Sería estupendo poder implementar a nivel europeo una tarjeta profesional que se base en contenidos estándares, como ya hemos visto es posible con el proyecto STEAM que ya han estado experimentando con ello. Sería interesante, que tendría que estar, digamos, coordinada y gestionada, monitorizada por un ente paritario del sector de la construcción, y de esta manera pues daríamos un empuje muy importante a todas nuestras empresas de la construcción para que se animen a realizar servicios con sus trabajadores fuera de nuestro propio, o sea, en otro Estado miembro de la Unión Europea, porque bueno, pues les facilitaría mucho el poder reconocer las competencias de sus trabajadores que en realidad también es uno de los primeros obstáculos que se encuentran a la hora de animarse a trabajar y hacer real este mercado único del sector de la construcción en el que estamos intentando todos trabajar por él. Y bueno, pues esto es, espero, de la VCA, como me has dado 5 minutos, no me va a dar tiempo a contar mucho. Luego, okay, si queréis, pues sigo. Gracias.
Io passo la parola invece a un filmato, perché abbiamo chiesto a Caterina De Cal, bravissima direttrice della Castedile di Udine, di andare a fare un'operazione di spionaggio in una impresa molto importante italiana che lavora in cantieri in tutto il mondo, per capire se poi le imprese serie, le famose buone pratiche, le imprese serie riescono, specie per i giovani, a pensare che un'esperienza di mobilità all'estero, un'esperienza di distacco, può essere un'esperienza che contribuisce a costruire non solo la formazione, ma proprio il curriculum professionale del lavoratore. E allora, se possiamo mandare questo estratto breve dell'intervento di Caterina, che oggi purtroppo aveva un impegno istituzionale e non poteva essere presente. Se possiamo mandare il video.
L'impresa è della quale vorrei brevemente parlare, è ICOFSPA, società benefit, e la quale ci riferisce di una buona prassi nella gestione dell'apprendistato in distacco. L'azienda opera in tutto il mondo, ma in questo particolare contesto desidera riferirci di un'esperienza con giovani apprendisti avviati in distacco nel nord Europa, in Danimarca, in Svezia e in Norvegia, dove solitamente opera con nella costruzione di stazioni della metropolitana sotterranea. In questo contesto operano anche degli apprendisti impiegati, che ragazzi che acquisiranno, nuove leve che acquisiranno il titolo di impiegati tecnici con mansione di tecnico di cantiere, che firmano un accordo, passano la selezione, naturalmente firmano un accordo con l'azienda, nella quale viene evidentemente descritto il proprio percorso di formazione, assegnato un tutor che è il responsabile del progetto, che li segue nelle varie fasi della loro preparazione. La formazione esterna del personale apprendistato avviato all'estero viene svolta comunque in Italia, con la collaborazione della locale scuola edile. Quella interna viene svolta on the job e all'estero presso i cantieri presso i quali sono avviati questi ragazzi. E ciascuna squadra avviata in distacco che ha operato in queste realtà del nord Europa opera con un minimo di 5, dalle 5 alle 20 persone, la metà delle quali sono ingegneri, a cui si aggiunge il giovane apprendista. I giovani selezionati, nella quasi totalità dei casi, si trovano ad affrontare per la prima volta un'esperienza di lavoro all'estero. Quali sono le caratteristiche peculiari del genere di formazione che viene offerto a questi ragazzi apprendisti avviati all'estero e in distacco? Gli aspetti principali riguardano la preparazione sugli aspetti della sicurezza. Sicurezza che già comunque svolge un ruolo chiave nella lavorazione dell'azienda. I ragazzi apprendisti hanno già, evidentemente, prima di essere avviati, completato il proprio percorso sulla sicurezza, percorso che assolutamente è testato. Ma una volta all'interno, assunto il proprio ruolo all'interno del cantiere, si trovano a dover affrontare, insieme a tutto il resto della squadra, dei periodici safety meeting che sono svolti in lingua inglese, safety meeting ai quali partecipano tutte le aziende, comprese i cantieri. E a questa preparazione importante, se ne aggiunge un'altra, ed è quella della quale appunto vogliamo riferire, l'organizzazione di quotidiani toolbox meeting, nei quali quotidiani toolbox meeting in italiano, nella, svolti da tutto il personale ICOP presente nel cantiere, il quale personale all'inizio della giornata lavorativa rivede, ripassa, riferisce quali, le lavorazioni che di lì a poco saranno svolte nel cantiere. Ma è la tipologia dell'insegnamento che questa buona prassi garantisce. I toolbox infatti contribuiscono a creare la squadra, per quanto riguarda l'azienda, i responsabili del progetto impartiscono e ricevono indicazioni univoche a tutto il personale della squadra, formano competenze di gruppo specifiche, specifiche peraltro di ogni cantiere, che realizzano una parte di bagaglio di competenze uniche, molto diverse dalla preparazione il momento. Gli apprendisti in distacco all'estero sviluppano effettivamente una sensibilità più solida e organica nei confronti delle problematiche basilari sul tema della sicurezza rispetto alle loro controparti che in Italia lavorano, e ottengono un approccio, ricevono un approccio ordinato e organico al lavoro di squadra e rispetto della precedenza, la cooperazione tra squadre. Ci suggeriscono i nostri referenti una possibile intervento a livello normativo che riconoscesse l'apprendistato e facilitasse il riconoscimento reciproco dei percorsi formativi, favorendo network fra gli enti formativi esteri accreditati. Attualmente infatti la preparazione esterna, voglio dire, dei ragazzi inviati in distacco viene svolta in Italia, e quindi potrebbe tutto questo favorire lo sviluppo e la replicazione di questo modello.
È un'esperienza concreta, si parla sempre di imprese formative, no? Bene, qui parliamo di grandi imprese che lavorano a livello internazionale, che portano con sé all'estero i giovani e li preparano presso la scuola edile prima di partire, li seguono durante l'esperienza all'estero e poi insieme alla scuola valutano al ritorno nel paese di invio qual è stata la crescita professionale. Si dice sempre che spesso i giovani rifiutano il settore delle costruzioni, ma se uno li accoglie, li segue e li coccola, li fa crescere e poi li fidelizza. E queste sono esperienze interessanti. Ma rimaniamo sul tema della istruzione e della formazione dei giovani. E noi abbiamo avuto in questo progetto la partecipazione davvero molto gradita, per la prima volta nel nostro partenariato, dell'Università Polis di Tirana. E chiamo in causa Ilda Rusi, che ringrazio per la collaborazione, per lo sforzo che ha fatto, perché mi rendo conto che per un'istituzione universitaria collaborare con noi, che siamo enti di settore, non è facile, e trovare anche il passo insieme. Ilda, voi mandate studenti all'estero, siano essi ingegneri o altre professioni, e i vostri percorsi di carriera a livello internazionale nel settore delle costruzioni li preparate e poi li seguite. Un tuo contributo, sempre nei 5 minuti, e un grazie, sperando di riavervi partner in futuri progetti.
Grazie per la introduzione, Giovanni. Buongiorno a tutti. I will switch directly into English. I will be try to be very brief. I'm happy, first of all, to give some insight from my institution, Polish University, and our country too, to this project. Well, education plays a role and in general should better align with the demands, not only current demands, but especially future demands for new employees. Lifelong learning requires also much more attention from employers and from employees. National educational and economic policies, on the other hand, should better highlight the need for lifelong learning, which unfortunately in Albania is still underdeveloped. We still have this vertical mismatch between educational attainment and employment of new graduates, and is still very high, counting 47% regarding or referring to INSTAT. And this has mainly to do with some reasons. First of all, insufficient of orientation of education to the needs of the labor market, and especially with a very low practical training of students. Many graduates have a job, but it's not well matched to their level of qualifications. And on the other hand, our country, Albania, has participated in the European qualifications framework since 2010, and since 2003 has been a full member of Bologna process and the European higher education area. So it has also signed and ratified the convention of the recognition of qualifications concerning higher education in the European region, which entered into force in 2002. At our institution, however, we have an office, Office of Student Support and Career Counseling, that informs students with full transparency of their academic and teaching issues and the specs related to them. And it also guides the students towards choosing their specific training areas according to their profile, their interest profile, according to the job market demands, and also to the opportunities they offer, playing also the role of mediator in between. The academic staff and also the students of Polis are constantly engaged in scientific activities in the form of exchanges and conferences. So Polis facilitates this process in three main forms. First of all, by organizing and leading workshops with students in accordance with their personal academic research, contributing to their advancement or improvement, involvement of students through summer schools or joint workshops with international partner schools such as TU Vienna, Graz, in Austria, University of Darmstadt, Mainz and Anhalt in Germany, Polytechnic of Athens, Thessaloniki, Patras Volos in Greece, Polytechnic of Serbia, La Sapienza, Tor Vergata, Politecnico di Bari and Trieste in Italy, University of Pristina in Kosovo, Lawrence Technological University in Michigan in USA, and etc. Another type is through organizing international mobility, where through activities initiated, first of all, by Polis and also Erasmus Plus programs or key action programs, a lot of students, I may say, have benefited from continued opportunities for exchange. And also through engaging the students in courses or studio courses under the umbrella of the Laboratory Innovation Factory or Fab Lab, where the knowledge and experimentation with the engineering field is focused on expanding and advancing more the concepts of today's related profession of civil engineering with the help of technology. And going back to the debate for universities' role, it has said that employability isn't a one-size-fits-all skills that can be taught, but universities can support students to translate their academic knowledge and skills for the workplace. So different seminars with CEOs and successful founders are available, also ensuring students that have to access to practical opportunities is very crucial. Building courses in tandem with business needs can provide students with practical work experiences, and also this is a way for students to begin building a network of professional contacts. From 2019, we provide our students with access to Gradua, graduates, advancement and development of university capacities in Albania. In fact, Graduate is a portal to the networking world, allowing our students to access job listings, to access internship opportunities and practical advices in order to prepare for their first steps into employment. The Graduate platform represents also a project funded by the European Commission through the Erasmus Plus initiative, which aims to support Albanian universities and Polish University also and students by creating an interactive data system, an interactive model that matches also the demand for employment of new graduates. And it also has been very useful for the younger students, our younger students that seek the jobs in the construction sector as well. More insight is needed to conclude. More pilot actions may be developed to start stressing the importance of adult participation in learning. And for the Albanian context, what needs to be done is, first of all, by enhancing the profile of professional education and training by guaranteeing the quality, by improving the teaching skills, industry experience, and academic knowledge, creating also transparency in learning outcomes, and increasing also some sustainable cooperation between the universities and the construction companies. This will enhance more the standardization of some of the components of the curricula, academic curricula, their unification towards more practicing, and while also increasing the time of professional practice in accordance with the market demands. That's all from our side. Thank you very much for your attention.
Grazie Ilka, ovviamente noi abbiamo in particolare come Italia un interesse perché a proposito di flussi su 500.000 e più, poco più, operai edili registrati nel nostro sistema delle casse edili italiane, 40.000 sono di origine albanese di prima e seconda generazione, ormai forse anche qualcosa di terza gassa. Ovviamente noi non abbiamo solo dei flussi in ingressi di operai edili, ma anche di tecnici e di validi professionisti, architetti, ingegneri, e quindi c'è un grande interesse da parte nostra di questo canale di collaborazione anche bilaterale. Essendo il flusso insieme a quello della Romania per quanto riguarda l'Italia più numericamente cospicuo, no? di scambio. Concludiamo questo giro di tavolo tornando in Spagna. Per Notus c'è Maria Caprile. A Maria chiediamo in conclusione di raccontarci l'esperienza del progetto My Skills, un caso di studio che, mi dice Feliciano, ha dato tanti spunti concreti alle raccomandazioni finali di IES, ma io direi che tutti gli interventi di oggi hanno contribuito forse ad arricchire il panel delle raccomandazioni finali. E voglio dire ai partner e a tutti gli spettatori che ci seguono, che sono stati tanti, che noi entro maggio pubblicheremo l'EU Toolkit, le linee guida finali, nelle 8 lingue previste, e in maniera da avere delle raccomandazioni che ciascuno dei partner potrà utilizzare sia in versione informatica ma anche in versione cartacea, per diffondere i risultati di progetto tra gli stakeholders di ciascun paese, nonché tra gli stakeholders a livello europeo. Maria, a te la parola.
Thank you, Giovanni. Also for the opportunity to collaborate again with TNC in Posted Workers. It has been quite a long journey since we started to work on the first post-lab project. I also want to say that YES has been special for us because the collaboration with our colleagues of the Labor Foundation of Construction Sector in Asturias And I think this has been quite a fruitful collaboration, and at least we at Notus have learned a lot of from this. So now about the My Skills project. First, the aim of this project is to facilitate the mobility of Spanish construction workers to Germany. And the promoters are the public employment services in Germany, specifically in Westphalia and in Spain. And they are supported by the EURES network. And the target group are workers who do not have a formal vocational degree or a similar professional certificate, and but have at least 1 year of professional experience in the construction sector. So the My Skill project is not for posted project, but we have seen that it can provide very useful insights for posting workers. So a key aspect of this project is that it relies on a system that allows workers to obtain an accreditation of professional experience through an online test of competences. So far, this tool, which is called My Skills, covers 4 occupational profiles in the construction sector and has been prepared by the Public Employment Services in Germany in collaboration with the Bertelsmann Foundation. So more or less, the process is that first, there is an identification of labor opportunities in Germany, and public employment services ask companies to identify which kind of competences are needed. Then in Spain, the public employment services disseminate this offer, pre-select candidates, and then support them to carry out this online self-assessment tool of competences. And then there is a support for the interviews with the German employments and to ensure that there is really skills matching. There are also other issues like labor, like German language course in Spain, access, the possibility to access to continuing education in Germany. There is also financial assistance for moving, and also assistance in finding housing in Germany. So in a nutshell, what we think that are key insights for supporting the use of posting to train young workers. No? First, it is very clear that in this case, working abroad is seen as an opportunity to gain professional experience and increase professional skills. And this is, I mean, the very core of the project. Second, we think that the My Skills tools is a good practice, or can be considered a good practice, for 2 main objectives. First, the accreditation of experience, and second, for ensuring the skills matchings of posted workers. And then what the My Skills project puts very, very clear is that there is a need to support posted workers. both in the posting country and also in the host country. And this means offer free language courses in the posting country, which can be or could be strengthened in the host country. To support accommodation and perhaps other needs like access to education, health, and other services. And a third aspect, which we think it is important, is that it also explores the possibility to give access to continuing education and training in the host country, which from our point of view is a very good opportunity for young workers who are in the stage of skilling. So I would say this is all from my side. Thank you very much.
Grazie Maria, io visto che abbiamo avuto un caso di studio in meno presentato, quello di Francesco De Falco che ci ha dovuto lasciare per un problema improvviso, ma che poi il caso della scuola edile di Arezzo e della mobilità di giovani all'estero nell'ambito dei curricoli formativi lo troverete sul sito come caso di studio italiano. Se c'è qualcuno dei relatori che vuole riprendere la parola brevemente per aggiungere qualcosa, a voi. Abbiamo ancora 10 minuti. Marta, vuoi presentarci brevemente la VCA?
La VCA es una experiencia que tenemos aquí en la fundación, que se desarrolla en un contexto específico, que es cuando las empresas quieren enviar a trabajar, desplazar a trabajadores, ¿no?, para realizar una actividad en otro Estado miembro. Entonces, normalmente los trabajos que realizan estos trabajadores que vienen suelen ser trabajos de supervisión o de mantenimiento, pues de obras, de actividades que tienen estas empresas españolas en los otros Estados miembros. VCA es, bueno, es en holandés son las siglas por salud, seguridad y medio ambiente. Y es una especie, perdón, es una especie de checklist para los empleadores, para las empresas. Estas empresas que mueven a las empresas, perdón, los profesionales que se desplazan a otro país miembro a realizar determinadas tareas, actividades de construcción o de montaje de andamios o de aislamientos, trabajos verticales, en algunos países les piden que tengan este certificado VCA. Estos países son, por ejemplo, Francia, Bélgica, Holanda, Dinamarca, Suiza, Alemania, Reino Unido. Entonces, con este certificado lo que hacen los trabajadores es poder probar que tienen suficientes conocimientos en materia de seguridad. En realidad, lo que está el VCA, digamos, chequeando es que son las empresas que van a hacer esa actividad en otro país miembro las que tienen realmente, digamos, un conocimiento de todos los aspectos que tienen relación con estos temas de seguridad medioambiental. En realidad, lo que hace es chequear más bien a la empresa. Y si ven que la empresa reúne estas condiciones, pues entonces el trabajador desplazado obtiene este certificado, ¿vale? Pero bueno, es el trabajador quien realmente obtiene el certificado. El VCA los pide la agencia de homologación belga, la BELAC, y lo que tiene es luego pues entidades homologadas en los estados miembros que ponen sus evaluadores. Los evaluadores VCA. Nuestra experiencia es que cuando una empresa de aquí, del territorio del Principado de Asturias, va a trasladar trabajadores desempleados, lo que hace es solicita que sus trabajadores pasen el VCA, se examinen. Entonces, a estos trabajadores hay una organización homologada VCA aquí en el norte de España que les suministra un manual y los trabajadores autónomamente pues miran ese manual y luego unos días antes del examen, ese manual tiene dos niveles, o sea, el UECA son dos niveles, el básico, que entonces los trabajadores lo hacen en español, el examen y el manual está en español, o el nivel de supervisor, que ya es en inglés, y entonces el examen lo tienen que pasar en inglés. Entonces, bueno, días antes del examen, los trabajadores vienen aquí a la fundación durante 8 horas con nuestros expertos y practican el examen, es decir, se preparan para hacer ese examen. Y luego el día del examen viene un evaluador VCA y se examinan aquí, pero es el evaluador VCA quien hace ese examen. Entonces, bueno, esta es nuestra experiencia, una propuesta que podría para, digamos, sacarle rentabilidad al VCA. El VCA, digamos que, bueno, es una buena práctica. No sabemos si esos contenidos formativos de seguridad, medio ambiente, bueno, se basan en estándares comunes europeos, es decir, que deriven de la directiva europea. Habría que verlo. Está parcialmente reconocido en Europa porque no son todos los Estados miembros quienes lo piden. Entonces, digamos que un paso más adelante podría ser tomar esta buena práctica, pero desarrollando, digamos, esquemas de certificación como en materia de prevención de riesgos laborales, pero siguiendo estándares internacionales como puede ser la ISO, ¿vale? Que es, además lo ligamos a una recomendación, la recomendación 9ª del toolkit. Entonces, bueno, hay una ISO que es la 17.024 para certificar a personas, que, bueno, podría ser interesante esta visión del VCA trasladarla un poco al uso de una ISO. Y bueno, si seguimos ligando buenas prácticas con la TPCA, con la TPC que vimos antes, pues esta ISO, digamos, por desarrollar en materia preventiva, de prevención de riesgos laborales que podrían tener los trabajadores, pues se podría luego quedar registrada en una base de datos común que compartamos todos en Europa, de tal manera que, bueno, pues podamos así pues ir intercambiando informaciones de nuestros trabajadores, igual que se está haciendo, por ejemplo, ahora a nivel de desplazamiento, que las autoridades laborales pues, bueno, intercambian información, pues bueno, esta podría ser también una forma de seguir ampliando un poco el espectro de la transparencia de la prevención de riesgos laborales para nuestros trabajadores europeos.
Marta, non so se c'è qualche altro amico relatore che vuole aggiungere qualcosa, e allora chiuderei questo interessante giro di tavolo ringraziando tutti voi per il contributo al progetto e darei la parola a Feliciano, che non solo chiuderà questa mattinata, ma vi perseguiterà nei prossimi 30 giorni per la rendicontazione e il rapporto finale.
Thank you, Michele. I won't steal much of your time and especially of the interpreter's time, as we are really with some delay. Yeah, just to stress once again that all the outputs, which do not include only the one we mentioned, but also case study, country in focus paper, news, are available on the project website, so yesproject.net. Nothing, I just want to thank the partnership once again, because it has been a difficult project, mainly for two reasons, for the ambition. So we have been investigating a topic which is not usually addressed when you talk about posting of workers, and we had to do so also by looking at other comparable situation and see how they could inspire improvement in the management of posting abroad by companies, in the way social partners approach the topic, and in the support public institutions provide, and also for the pandemic. Those have been two difficult years. Nevertheless, we have managed to stay in track and to adapt and keep on cooperating with different means, with new methods, or reinventing a little bit the project, also with the help of the commission that was quite keen to help us and understand all our different needs. So the cooperation will prosecute in further projects, and is prosecuting with most of you already in the MX project, whereby we are addressing more specifically the topic of health and safety at work, which is becoming key. We talk about Italy, the number of accidents with the recovery of the sector is increasing. So certainly this is a urgent topic, and I'm happy that we can address it and provide also some proposals, some insight departing from research, as we have done actually also with the YES project. So all work will prosecute with the publication of this report, and also to promote the important results we have achieved towards our partners or stakeholders.
Scusami, c'è la nostra vicepresidente Cristina Raghitta che ci ha raggiunto e che voleva dare il suo contributo e il suo saluto. Le cedo la scrivania proprio materialmente. Dai, Cristina.
Sì, buongiorno, scusate il ritardo, eravamo impegnati in un'altra riunione, ma ci tenevo a rubarvi due minuti per portarvi un po' il saluto, perché questo è per noi della CNCE un progetto importante, a parte questo sfondo inquietante, comunque è un progetto importante che ha affrontato il tema appunto della mobilità dei giovani e della necessità che questa mobilità attraverso il ricorso al distacco, ma in generale pone un tema fondamentale della formazione professionale, della formazione alla sicurezza, dell'alfabetizzazione linguistica, dell'inclusione e della promozione della cittadinanza dei lavoratori in paesi terzi. Diciamo che la ripresa del settore dopo la crisi pandemica del 2020 ha prodotto nei paesi partners una domanda molto forte di manodopera, a cui si è data una risposta attraverso un aumento della mobilità verso i mercati più sviluppati, quindi con un flusso di maestranze provenienti da paesi che tradizionalmente costituiscono bacini di manodopera. Per questa ragione la mobilità nel futuro risulterà una delle chiavi di volta per rispondere alla forte domanda di manodopera da parte delle imprese. È anche per questo che la campagna del sindacato europeo perché ci sia una mobilità governata, non lasciata a un flusso incontrollato, prevedendo l'utilizzo corretto dell'istituto del distacco, assume per il nostro settore un ruolo assolutamente centrale. La CNCE ha portato avanti quindi questa linea progettuale in campo europeo sulla mobilità di imprese e di lavoratori, raccogliendo una serie di 11 paesi, apportando particolare attenzione sul tema dell'informazione e della conoscenza delle condizioni di lavoro sul territorio internazionale. L'obiettivo che ci siamo posti è quello di riconoscere che attraverso una corretta protezione sociale, perché questo è sicuramente il primo obiettivo che ci diamo, il movimento di imprese e lavoratori può e deve essere un'esperienza che arricchisce tutto il settore, ma solo questo arricchimento può avvenire se questa esperienza è monitorata e gestita correttamente. Grazie alla peculiarità del sistema bilaterale italiano delle costruzioni è stato possibile mettere in campo degli strumenti assolutamente innovativi finalizzati a aiutare le imprese e i lavoratori in un percorso di lavoro sicuro e maggiormente tutelato, con l'obiettivo di stabilire un mercato unico europeo basato sulla qualità e sul contratto. Come sistema, noi sicuramente questo è il primo obiettivo che ci diamo e riteniamo che questi percorsi siano fondamentali per ragionare tutti insieme di come sia possibile creare un mercato di lavoro equo, garantire dei flussi di manodopera che abbiano come presupposto quelli sì del mercato, ma prima di tutto della tutela dei lavoratori intesi nella loro specificità di persone, di migranti e di lavoratori che devono vedere riconosciuti i loro diritti. I flussi non controllati sono dei flussi che generano sfruttamento e noi dobbiamo impedire che in un settore come il nostro, che effettivamente è spesso un settore di primo approdo per chi arriva in un paese straniero, perché magari ha delle necessità, soprattutto in questo contesto europeo così difficile, dobbiamo prevedere che questi flussi e questi migranti, queste persone trovino un sistema che li accoglie, ma che li accoglie solo non rispetto a un'esigenza di lavoro, ma anche rispetto e soprattutto a un'esigenza di garanzie dei diritti, a un'esigenza di garanzia di cittadinanza, non nel senso chiaramente legale del termine, ma del riconoscimento di persone, soprattutto a maggior ragione quando questi sono profughi, che devono essere accolti e tutelati e vedere riconosciute quelle che sono le loro prerogative. Io ringrazio tutti voi che avete partecipato a questo percorso, perché credo che questi percorsi siano veramente una chiave per costruire non solo delle regole, ma anche delle sensibilità comuni che ciascuno di noi deve calare nel proprio contesto per vedere riconosciuta appunto quella valorizzazione delle persone, che è il primo vero valore del capitale umano, anche delle aziende e di un'economia equa. Vi ringrazio.
Grazie Cristina, e io saluterei tutti, e quindi arrivederci ai prossimi appuntamenti anche nel progetto EMEX con il partenariato.